So, in the first two lectures, we focus our attention on two-dimensional systems, the topological order, which is essentially the Varic order, and the general models which describe anionic fluids. And today, instead, I would like to focus to a one-dimensional case, which has some relevance for experiments, and it is the case of Majorana zero moments in topological superconductors. So, to grab the meaning of these Majoranas, yesterday I introduced their statistics, their characteristics, but we didn't speak about their origin. So now we would like to present you a couple of models that allows us to obtain Majorana zero moons. The first model will be more theoretical, this is called the Kitak chain, and the second one instead has more, it's more closer to the experimental systems. So let us start from the main toy model, due to Kitaev, which is a model of one-dimensional fermion, so fermions hopping in a one-dimensional chain, where we have an on-site energy potential, then we have an hopping term, but now I add a term which is a superconducting variant. So, you see that essentially the first two elements are symmetric for a gauge transformation, a generic UR gauge transformation, because you can mark CS in CS prime some phase, and the first two elements are invariant for this global transformation. Whereas this term breaks this global symmetry. And actually it breaks this U1 symmetry to a Z2 symmetry. What does it mean? It means that this Hamiltonian does not conserve in general the fermionic number, because you see that this term allows to create or annihilate pairs of fermions, but it just conserves the overall fermionic parity, which we can label by. So this is a conserved quantity for this Hamiltonian, which has this Z2 symmetry. This can be either plus 1 or minus 1. In particular, this delta tilde is a general complex, and there is some phase. It was related like di theta. And we can exploit the fact that this term break the gauge symmetry to erase this phase, and it is essentially sufficient to do a transformation like this one, where I put here delta over 2, and you see that here this phase erases the one of the other parameter for the superconductor, so that essentially I can rewrite the same Hamiltonian in this new basis without the complex terms, not only with real parameters. This is just a mathematical trick, but however, so for the moment you can more or less forget about it. At some point you will see that these two enters in some physical phenomenon and has its own importance. From the point of view of physics, I would like to say that this is a superconducting term, But since I'm not considering any spin in this Hamiltonian, it must be considered like a p-wave superconductor. So it couples essentially pairs of fermions with the same string, which is not so usual in physical systems. And it is the main objection about the feasibility of this Hamiltonian. But we will see that there are tricks around that. And yes,
there is a binding.
The sound is
yes, of course.
Yes. And so to understand the physics of this Hamiltonian, I would like to apply a simplification for just the sake of simplicity, and I will impose that the tunneling term is equal to delta, just because in this particular case it is easier to understand what it is going on. So the Hamiltonian that I consider is actually this one. But however, if you change, neglect this equality and you add generic terms, more or less the phase diagram of the Hamiltonian remains the same. And I can rewrite this Hamiltonian like Cx, and I rearrange this term like minus delta divided by 2, and here I collect the sum over x, and here I collect minus gamma 2x gamma 2x plus 1. So it's some L. So you see that in terms of these new degrees of freedom, we obtain essentially a staggered Hamiltonian with two different components. The first one corresponds to the excited energy potential, and the second one corresponds to this tunneling equal to the parent term. So that if we represent this as a chain, and the origin, the original model I had the organic sites. Now I'm splitting these organic sites in two. And I'm obtaining an Hamiltonian in terms of these are the gamma, of course, number one, number two, number three, and so on and so forth. And I have that the mu term is a link between gammas taken from the same site. These are the moons. And the parent term instead couples my runners from different sites. And so it is interesting to understand what it is going on to map this model actually to the easy model, because I haven't done it so far, but once I put C equal to delta, this is just the easy model. And to delta, you can simply apply the Jordan-Minkowski transformation such that x minus 1 becomes sigma x. Point. So we have to get phase where essentially easing, I have that for that greater than mu, I am in the ferromagnetic phase where the symmetry is broken, and since the symmetry is broken, I have two degenerate ground states. And instead, if mu is greater than delta, the magnetic field prevails, and I am in the paramagnetic phase with only a single ground state. And so the underlying symmetry is exactly the Z2 symmetry we are considering before, that of course in terms of the easing just becomes the product of all the sigma Z effects, which comes with the easing. So to understand a little bit what is going on in terms of these gamma operators, you can consider the two limits in which mu is equal to 0 or delta is equal to 0. So if delta is equal to 0, you see that we have these orange couplings disappear. I am pairing each pair of majorans from the same fermionic site, and I am left, as expected, with a single ground state. Namely, the ground state is characterized by the fact that all the terms gamma 2 minus 1 gamma 2 are must be equal to plus 1. So this is what we obtain, and essentially it corresponds to have no fermions in my original theory. Instead, the opposite limit is more interesting because first in the opposite limit I have some coupling that appears, but the coupling that appears is from between majoranas taken in different fermionic sites, and this means that in the bulk I am coupling all these pairs, and I obtain the new condition gamma 2 r.
For mu equals 0, do you
think? For, yes, for mu equals 0 and delta is different from 0. And this must be equal to 1. So essentially, in the bulk, what happens is that the two phases are more or less one translation of the other, or one sign in terms of this this Majorana chain, Majorana modes. But I am left with two uncoupled Majoranas that have gamma 1 and gamma 2n essentially. And since, you can verify easily that these two Majoranas, taken singularly, they commute with all the terms of your Hamiltonian, because a Majorana always commutes with a pair of other Majoranas. So if you do gamma 1, I gamma 2, I gamma 2 plus 1, you have a commutation, and so gamma 1 and gamma 2n are symmetries of the Hamiltonian in this particular case. So I don't know. This is of course only in this particular limit. But these two do not commute with themselves. So I obtain that this degeneracy, that the easing model is given by symmetry breaking, now can be characterized by these two symmetries. And in particular, I will have two degenerate ground states that assume a different value of this operator. Must be careful because since all the other pairs fuses into one, it means that the fermionic parity of the bulk rearranged by the fine mu, C and C double, that now are obtained from two different fermionic sites. So this fermionic parity is fixed and it is equal to plus one. So this in the limit mu equal to zero becomes equal to the fermionic parity that is just our global symmetry of the system. So essentially, if we reason about, if we discuss a little bit about the spectrum of this system, we obtain that in this limit, and you may imagine that if you perturb a little bit this mu equals zero, so you are left in the case where mu is smaller than that but different from zero, more or less should be more or less stable because you are in the same phase. So in the spectrum you will observe that there are two degenerate ground states, or almost degenerate if you consider finite systems, that are characterized by this condition and by different values of different of these operators. So they assume a value plus one or minus one.
So in this model, it's important that you have these open boundaries.
Yes, it is crucial that they have open boundaries.
But yep, with the analogy with the transverse field easing model, that will still have two degenerate ground states even if you have periodic boundary conditions.
But they have a different fermionic number. Yes, I'm not discussing the periodic boundary condition. I want to stick to the open boundary condition. Otherwise, my runs appear, and in this case, I guess that usually I remove the genus. So I have to think about better about it. But let us consider just the open.
If you look in terms of the holonomy produced by the topological phase, even with the periodic boundary conditions, you still have a phase transition.
Can you repeat it again?
You can do this with periodic boundary conditions, and you still have a change in the topological order.
Yes, you have, and yes, and you have also some tool to detect the difference between topological and non-topological phase. So I haven't said it, but because Majorana is corresponds to the topological phase because of this degeneracy, and this is the non-topological phase, and there is a physical phenomenon that I would like to discuss later, which is the Flaxman-Josephson effect that appears only in one of the phases and not in the other, and allows me to understand what is going on also for periodic boundary condition but with a sort of defect in the middle. So it is not strictly speaking again a periodic boundary condition. But I would like to stress that we are considering open boundary condition.
It's just a comment. To you comment. It's a transformation from gamma to sigma to the torque if you have a
Yes, the job. Yes, you have to impose some constraints on the strings. So, I will tell you that we see at least in this limit, but this holds up to the critical point, that the spectrum is double degenerate, then we will have some gap, and here we are populating the spectrum in a different way. And so we have that if we apply some local operators in terms of the CC diagram, in terms of the gamma, we may move on the excited states. But the important thing is that to have a transition between these two states, we must have some operator which violate the fermionic parity at the level of the first Hamiltonian. So if you have something which is quadratic in the gammas, you will never obtain a transition from one to the other. And so unless you add a fermion to your system, you cannot have these transitions. Furthermore, the other important thing is that only through local observations, so if you apply some measurement that involve only gammas in a small domain, you cannot distinguish between this state and this other state. So essentially this is similar to one of the conditions that we saw to have topological order. From local measurement we cannot distinguish the two states, and operators which do not violate the fermionic parity cannot allow transition from the two ground states. So essentially here we have that this degeneracy is not really protected for something from some by something which is topological, like in the case of the toric code, but still it is protected by this fermionic parity conservation. So that usually these phases are called also symmetric protective topological phases. Topological because you need something which is non-local to distinguish the two states, and protected because of this difficulty in having transitions from one ground state to the other. So, however, so far we consider strictly these limits. Now I would like to understand better what happens if we are in the same phase but below the critical point, in such a way that I want to show you that this Majorana zero moves on the boundaries of the system survive even if we extend our calculation to be different from zero. So let me rewrite the Hamiltonian. And in particular, let us consider the commutator between the first gamma on the one, which is the decoupled Majorana in the limit with the Hamiltonian, and this commutator becomes simply gamma 2 with a sign which is this. And instead we can consider, for example, the commutator of an odd Majorana more in the part of the system, and here we obtain two terms. And in general, if I start from gamma 1, I have that the residual commutator between gamma 1 and h was like mu, and it is in gamma 2, with smaller than this. If now I consider gamma 1 plus mu over delta gamma 3, you can sum these term and this term multiplied by gamma delta, and you obtain that this commutator, in this commutator gamma 2 disappears, and I am left with minus I mu squared over t gamma 4. But since mu is smaller than 1, essentially I'm reducing this commutator by adding this term. And you may mention of doing a cascade of this thing, so that now I add plus mu square over delta square gamma 5, and instead of adding this commutator, I will obtain a commutator which is 5 to the third power t of delta squared gamma 6. So by adding terms to this boundary mode, I obtain that the commutator decreases and decreases and decreases. And in particular, I can define an operator which is localized, exponentially localized on close to the left edge, that I call gamma L, which is equal to the sum of mu over the power of the power n. Transform, which is simply the continuation of this cascade, and I obtain that this operator has h, which essentially goes like mu over delta to the number of fermionic sites in my system. Mu gamma n. But I remind you that we are in the limit where this term is smaller than 1. So this commutator is exponentially decaying with the system size. In the thermodynamic limit, this is asymmetry. And essentially, you see that this, in this definition, also the terms entering inside gamma L are decaying exponentially, so that you may imagine that gamma L is equal to the sum of some e minus x over some characteristic length of gamma to x plus 1, but this is the logarithm of this ratio. So this is a mode which in the thermodynamic limit commutes with the Hamiltonian, and which is localized. Both these characteristics are true up to exponential suppressions. And I can do the same on the right side by considering the even gammas essentially, and I will obtain a new zero energy mode for is Hamiltonian, which is instead localized on the right edge, and I can write it like gamma r, which is equal to sum n equal to 0 gamma plus 2 n again over delta the power n, which is exactly the same. So the important thing is that if you take these gammas, these big gammas, and you do a square, you obtain a number, a C number, so that you may normalize them, and essentially you have that this behave like the gamma operators we had before. Furthermore, they anti-commute. These products here only the odd terms enter, here only the even terms enter, and each term of this sum commutes with one term of the other sum. So we see essentially that even in this case we have some Majorana mode which approximately commutes with the Hamiltonian, and one is localized in this part of the system, and the other is localized in that part of the system. And they provide again this structure of the spectrum, because now I can consider a new fermionic number essentially, which is given by gamma left. Gamma right, and this distinguishes the two ground states. And again, to have a transition from one to the other, I have to change the fermionic parity of my system. Furthermore, these objects are stable against stronger perturbation. Essentially, I can also consider now an Hamiltonian in which this mu depends on the site, mu of x, and this delta depends on the site, delta of x. And however, I require that in average, mu of x must be smaller than delta of x. And in this case, you see that instead of having this power, I substitute this power with the product from E equal to 0 to n of mu of E over delta of E. And I obtain exactly the same result. So by perturbing this Hamiltonian with local operators that are either of the kind, let's say epsilon gamma to r gamma to r plus 1, or so I imagine random in terms of this kind, or epsilon 2 gamma to r plus 1 gamma to r plus 2, the existence and the characteristic of the characteristics of these two zero modes are stable against this disorder. And so this is what I wanted to show. Furthermore, however, you can generalize the existence of these modes also to more complicated quadratic terms, and you can see that they survive also when t is different from delta, if they are not too far apart. So essentially, they always survive if you remain in this ferromagnetic phase. And this is demonstrated by Kitaeva. I consider other techniques and describing these with matrices, and this becomes a little bit complicated. But to give you a flavor that these modes are somehow stable unless you undergo some phase transition. So you go for a critical point, and once you close the gap, the critical point, you close this gap, and everything is mixed in a different way, and you lose this. This mode. So, the other important thing, however, is that so far we consider those open boundary conditions, but these modes actually appear every time we have an interface between a topological and a non-topological phase. So, let us change a little bit our Hamiltonian and consider a domain wall between the two phases. So that now I label things in this way. Essentially, I will have these are the gammas, so I will have some gamma 1 here, then gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 4, gamma 5. But I consider also gamma 0, gamma minus 1, gamma minus 2. And in particular, I create here a domain wall in such a way that on the right I have that delta r is greater than r, so that we are in the topological phase, which means that essentially we have strong couplings between these and between these and so on and so forth. Whereas on the other side, we consider the non-topological phase, trigger phase, and here we obtain that the strong couplings are of the other kind. So these ones and that ones. So you must assume that at the beginning, here we had the fermionic size, something like that, then something like that. And in this case you see that the strong coupling is between majorans of the same fermionic site, and here we have the left is greater than that alert, or remains CW2. Instead, here we have the strong coupling is between Majorana and different fermionic slides. So this is the domain of the fermionic phases. And you can apply the same tricks with the commutators that we did before, and you will obtain a particular edgemont, which is exponentially localized here, which reads, I can write it down like gamma zero plus the sum level left over left the power and minus one plus the sum of the opposite and the right the power of the here so essentially you have two different length speeds on the left and on the right that are given by these two ratios that are small and you may verify that approximately this commutes with this new Hamiltonian and that it is so exponentially localized and then if somewhere else I have another domain wall what I obtain is that there will be some other Majorana which anticommutes with this one and so the important thing to understand here is that these objects are always they always appear to an interface between a trivial region and a topological region. In particular, at the beginning, considering open boundary condition, the trivial region was just the bottom. And so I guess that for the Kitaev model, we can end here. However, now we'd like to move to more physical stuff because, as I told you, it is very difficult to engineer some system in which you really have the P wave current term. And however, there are tricks around it, and it has been shown that usually, if you consider a system, one dimensional system in which you have in orbit. Orbit coupling plus an S wave superconducting term plus some correct Zeeman term, then the low energy physics described by this system, and the low energy physics which characterizes this system, can be cast, can be described by the detection. However, here the calculations are a bit longer, so I prefer to show you a different setup. But by the way, these systems are very important from the experimental point of view because you may have heard that in 2012 in Delft and in other laboratories they started to work with systems where they have nanowires with strong spin-orbit coupling, for example, of indium arsenide or indium antimonide, and they managed to put them on top of superconductors in such a way that they have some proximity-induced superconducting pairing, and in this way, by adding the correct magnetic fields, you should be able to see a Majorana feeling at the interface between the topological phase where there is the superconducting term and the trivial phase where this superconducting term is absent. And actually, they obtained some first measurement based on transport measures, so you may imagine some measure of the current between here and there. And this. There is a signature of these transport properties which is exactly given by the degeneracy that we were considering before because usually if you have a superconductor you can't have both the fermionic parts, all the fermions here are paired in two pair pairs, and if you add an electron, you must pay some big price in energy. Whereas if you have Majorana's, you can host one fermion inside the Majorana's appearing there, and well, this has some implication in the current that you mentioned that it has been seen. So so far there is no clear-cut experimental demonstration of the Majorana's, but this experiment in Delft was done really carefully, and it is very difficult to explain the results with other models that do not involve Majorana. However, this is of course not enough to demonstrate their characteristics in terms of non-linear statistics, for example, to let it work after, but there are good experimentalists that are trying to do so. And, well, so I was telling you that instead of discussing this system in nanowires, I would like to present you a slightly simpler setup from the conceptual point of view, or at least from the calculation point of view, which is obtained by coupling the edges of topological insulators to superconductors. And well, said in this way, it seems very complicated. But actually what I want to achieve is to have counter-propagating fermionic moons. Just a second. So I would like to get a system in which I have some edge moons going in these lines. So you have to imagine that here we will have some fermion with a left helicity and spin up, and here we will have some right propagating fermion with spin down. They move on the same edge, and this edge is the edge between the topological insulator and the vacuum, essentially. I don't really want to explain what is a topological insulator, but you can imagine it. The ones of you who know about quantum wall know that in the integer quantum wall you have a single edge mode which is a fermion which propagates chirally in one direction. This topological insulator can be seen also as a quantum spin wall system, and there are two pairs of these quantum wall systems that are related by time reversal symmetry. So you see that in the edge there appear two gapless edge modes, and by applying the time reversal symmetry I map the right moving with one spin in the left move the other spin. So I have a Fermion which characterizes the system that is proportional to the integral of C left. Velocity some other constant, but this is the starting point where you see that this system is again range invariant and it is gapless. To open a gap in this system, we may consider different terms of interaction. The first interaction can be considered as proportional to a backscattering term, which essentially is driven by a coupling constant, and I assume that this may be in space, and it is just C dark right, C left, just Hermitian conjugate. So you see that since the right has one polarization and the left has the opposite spin, this is just a ferromagnetic backscattering. You may imagine it as a magnetic field that is perpendicular to this spin. So that essentially this term will be strong if I consider a situation in which on top of this topological insulator edge I attach a big ferromagnet. so that the capping constant is very strong in this region, and then it drops to zero outside this region. That's why I want to write this partial inheritance. So this is essentially the term which breaks the time reversal symmetry. And it opens again, which is proportional to that. The other term that we may consider instead breaks the particle conservation number, the number, the conservation of particle number, and it is a superconducting term, which instead is proportional to some delta of x, and here we have slight darker right, slight darker left. In principle, this could depend on the phase. So far, I prefer to neglect the phase because it doesn't really matter. So, left. So you see that here, again, as before, I am breaking the U1 symmetry and I break it into a Z2 symmetry so that only the fermionic part of the edge now is conserved and not its fermionic number. And this corresponds to adding a normal superconductor, so an S-wave superconductor in another region. And essentially, this is because the right movers and the left movers have opposite spin for this. So that this is the system that I want to study a little bit now. And you may understand that I am somehow creating a domain void between two different phases, because I'm starting from a gapless system, and I'm opening two gaps in different ways by breaking two different symmetries. And this more or less corresponds to the thing that we were considering here, where we had a system with some symmetry and breaking the symmetry into different things. Perhaps we can do a pause now, and then I will do some more. If there are questions.